Hello. Hey, y'all good? Wow, this looks great. A lot of people here today. It's so exciting to see walls coming down and people coming out, and God's going to move today. It's so good to see you. We had a really good first service. I know God moved over there as well, but looking forward to what he's going to do today. If you see, we got some new things in the, new old things in the pews. That's good. Another step forward. Thank you. In there is this card. It's this card. Thank you for coming card. If this is your first time here, we want you to fill it out on the back. There's some information about about you, and we're not going to sell this to any publisher, clearinghouse, or anything. But we just want to know that you're here, so we can say thank you for being here. And if you're at all interested in our new members class, I know Pastor will talk about this in a moment also. Every month we have a new members class. If you're wanting to know more about our church, it's not a you have to come, you have to join if you come, but it's a chance for us to get to know you. You get to know us a little better. There's a box on there. Mark that as well. And as you go out in the back in the offering plate, that'll be your offering for today. Just put that in there, and we'll get up with you this week or next. So just glad that you're here with us. We have a lot of visitors from out of town during this time. So glad you're here. All the announcements I have, we're going to worship together today. Why don't you stand with me, and I'll pray, and we'll get started. Lord, thank you for today. What a beautiful day it is outside, and just to see the sun shining down on us today. Lord, we felt your presence in the first service just move mightily, and we look forward to what you're going to do in this one. Thank you for Pastor. Just pray for him as he brings your word, that you would be free to move in the words that he has today. We love you, Lord. Thank you for loving us. In your name, amen. Mercy there was great, and grace was free. Let's sing.
Years I spent in vanity and pride, caring not my Lord was crucified. Knowing God it was for me, he died on Calvary. Yeah.
friend we have in Jesus.
For you are my righteousness. He molded and built a small lonely hill that he knew would be called Calvary. Then he made the seed that would grow to be thorns that would make his son bleed. Then he made a green stem, gave it leaves, and then gave it sunshine and rain, and sheltered it with moss. He grew the tree that he knew would be used to make an old rugged cross. Nothing took his life with love he gave it. He was crucified on a tree that he created. Great love for man made God stay with his plan. He grew the tree so that we might go free. With tears in his eyes, God looked down through time, saw him sped upon, rejected and mocked. Still he grew the tree that he knew would be used to make an old rugged cross. Nothing took his life with love he gave it. He was crucified on a tree that he created. Great love for man made God stay with his plan. He grew the tree so that we might go free. He grew the tree that he knew would be used to make an old rugged cross.
Great job, Dixie. Thank you so much for that. Well, church, good to see you. Good morning. Let's turn together to 2 Corinthians chapter 11. Let me remind you again, if you're visiting, thank you for being here, and we're so glad that you came. If you'd like to fill out a visitor's card for us, we'd appreciate it. They're in the back by the basket. And if you are a multi-time visitor and are thinking about joining the church, that's usually how it goes. After you come a few times, you start thinking it's time to join this place. Well, we've got a new members class coming up, and on the visitor's card that we've got in the back, there's a box you can check that says, sign me up for the next class. So if you'll get one of those, a lot of them are in the pews also as well. You can find them there. Get these visitor's card, fill it out, turn it in for us, and we'll contact you and let you know what time we're meeting. We'd love for you to come to that. 2 Corinthians chapter 11, we're going to finish verse 21 and go down through verse 29. And today I want to talk to you about credibility You know, in this day and time, a lot of people are looking for somebody that's legitimate, somebody that's real. They want to know that you're not a fake or a phony, that you really are who you say that you are. And that's something that the Apostle Paul is having to deal with. He's written this text in large part as an answer to an accusation made against him by false apostles that had crept into the church of Corinth and had claimed to be on at least a level as high, if not higher, than the Apostle Paul. They're doing this to try to manipulate the church, to try to take over control of it, trying to use it to enrich themselves and gain prominence and position. And so Paul is writing back to try to help the church to understand that he really is the real deal and all these things that have been said about him are not true, because he has been the man that God has raised up to be an apostle, to give truth not just to the first century church, but to the church of all time. So you want to know that somebody's credible. And Paul's showing his credentials, as it were, as we read this text. Very much like if somebody said, I'm a law enforcement officer, you'd want to see the badge. Well, Paul's going to show you something here by telling you something about his life. Now, when you think about being credible or being real, we can apply that to our lives in a lot of different ways. For instance, am I a real Christian? What is a real Christian? How do I know that I'm credible? Or even as God has been using some of your lives or working some of your lives to raise you up to be a leader in the Christian community one day, how do you become a credible leader? That's not something that's usually gained very quickly. It's gained over time, but there are some things you can learn about credibility from this text to apply to your life, as well as to take great confidence away in the Apostle Paul. So let me read the text to you, and I'm going to talk to you about a false credibility as well as a genuine credibility. And when I talk about credibility, I'm going to talk about it matters what you do, what you endure, and what you feel. And then I'll wind it up by giving you some applications at the end just to tie it all together. Here's the second part of verse 21 down to verse 29. Let me read it to you now. It says, but in whatever respect anyone else is bold, I speak in foolishness, I am just as bold myself. Are they Hebrews? So am I. Are they Israelites? So am I. Are they descendants of Abraham? So am I. Are they servants of Christ? I speak as if insane, I more so. In far more labors, in far more imprisonments, beaten many times without number, often in danger of death. 5 times I received from the Jews 39 lashes. 3 times I was beaten with rods. Once I was stoned. 3 times I was shipwrecked. A night and a day I have spent in the deep. I have been on frequent journeys, in dangers from rivers, dangers from robbers, dangers from my countrymen, dangers from the Gentiles, dangers in the city, dangers in the wilderness, dangers on the sea, dangers among false brethren. I've been in labor and hardship, through many sleepless nights in hunger and thirst, often without food and cold and exposure. Apart from such external things, there is the daily pressure on me of concern for all the churches. Who is weak without my being weak? Who is led into sin without my intense concern? Now, the Apostle Paul is writing to answer what has been said about these false apostles. And one of the ways that these false apostles had built their own selves up is by being Jewish people who had come from Jerusalem supposedly with letters stating things that would give them credibility in the eyes of those who would receive the letters. And so their Jewish nature is something they use to prop themselves up. If you want to, in verse 22 in the margin, you might want to just write verse 5 just to, in your mind, to reference this later on if you ever go back. Verse 5 of this same chapter says, I consider myself not in the least inferior to the most eminent apostles. So what they had tried to say is that they're greater than Paul, and Paul says, no, I'm not any inferior to them at all. And certainly one of the things they used was their Jewish nature. Another thing they might claim is that they work for the Lord, and that's what Paul addressed in verse 23. And then he even talks about them as workers, saying, I may be insane talking this way. And that's because another thing you might want to mark in your Bible outside of verse 23 is number 13, verse 13. Paul reminds us, such men are false apostles, deceitful workers, distinguishing themselves as apostles of Christ. They're liars, they're deceits, they're fakes. So Jewishness, working, and then Paul talks in large part in the next section about his suffering. Now, those three things I just mentioned right there, his heritage, the work, as well as the suffering, all of those things are things that in some way can instill credibility in someone's eyes towards someone else. The world will certainly find much credibility in that. Now, when we talk about being credible, though, again, we're talking about being real, being genuine. So let me just use those three things real quickly in kind of a flip, kind of turn it around a little bit, and let me talk about a false credibility that those things can lead to when it comes to being a Christian anyway. Because sometimes people get these ideas in their mind that lead them down a road they shouldn't go down. For instance, they might say something to themselves or maybe even out loud sometimes and say, you know, I wish that I was blank because I believe if I was that, that would help me to get to God or get to know God, or I might have an inroad with God, something like that. And one of the things they might use is their heritage. A Jewish person would say, my being Jewish, being that race, might help me. And people today, even people that aren't Jewish, might say, you know, I'd have a better shot of getting to heaven if I was Jewish. People think along those lines. People might say, you know, if I do a lot of stuff, if I work really hard, like he's talked about in here, that might give me an inroad. Or if I suffer greatly, that might give me some kind of inside track to get to God. There's this thought today that, you know, if I suffer greatly in this life, in the next life, God's going to make it up to me. Think about a lady that might have been born to a poor family, had a tough home life, married someone that turned out to be a scoundrel, had children that grew up to be wayward, early in life got a debilitating disease that was long-term and painful and died an excruciating death. And somebody might in the back of their mind say, you know, I know that she's in a better place now. After all she suffered in this life, certainly God's made it up to her in the next. Suffering, a heritage like many today might say, well, I come from a Christian nation, so obviously I'm a, you know, a person of God, or I have a father that was a pastor or a grandmother that was a missionary. You know, all these sorts of the ideas people have, but it leads you to have a false credibility, a false idea of being genuine when you're not really that. Because no matter what you suffered, no matter how much you worked, and no matter where you come from, none of those things are going to get you to heaven. The only one that brings us to God is the Lord Jesus Christ. And faith in Jesus is the only way of coming to God. So those sorts of things, if you had that and had nothing else, the suffering, the heritage, the works, all of that would lead you down a dead-end road that would lead to a place called hell if you die without the Lord Jesus Christ. In fact, if you suffered greatly in this life, and people might think, well, she's got to be in a better place. No, you actually go to a worse place if you go into a Christless eternity, and you would suffer even more greatly than you ever did in this life. Suffering in this life doesn't mean you get a better life in the next life. Jesus is the way to get a better life in the next life. Jesus is the way to it's his work that he does for us, living a perfect life, dying on the cross, coming back to life again, believing in what Jesus has done gets us there, not our own works. And so it can even lead you to down a false road if you say, well, I believe in Jesus, but I'm going to add some stuff to what I believe, such as trusting in my family or trusting in my works or trusting in my suffering. What that really is it's not faith at all. Because what you're saying is, I believe in Jesus, but I also believe he's not enough, and I got to do something else. Jesus is enough. What he has done is sufficient. We believe in Christ alone. We come to God through faith alone, and we receive eternal life through grace alone. We don't earn it, don't buy it, none of that. So there is a false credibility I want to warn you against having, especially when it comes to talking about being a genuine, born-again believer. You can't have these other things and think they're going to get you to God or even give you an inside road to God. No, the only way to get to God is through faith in the Son of God, the Lord Jesus Christ. You're not going to be any closer to God because of any of those things. It's Jesus alone that does that for us. Now, having said that, for those that are truly born again, truly have put your faith in Jesus Christ, repented of your sin, believed in him for eternal life, receiving that gift of eternal life through faith in Jesus, for those, credibility can come in your life through what you do, through what you endure and what you feel. Let me tell you how I see that here. Look at verse 23 again. Paul says, are they servants of Christ? I speak as if insane. I more so. Again, why does it sound crazy for him to say that they're servants of Christ? Because, you know, they're fakes. They're frauds. They're phonies. But they claim to be serving Jesus, and Paul's saying, you know, they're saying they're greater than me, and they aren't. It's a lie. Paul says, I more so in far more labors. Now, what does that mean, that word labors? That's a word that means to work, to toil to the point of exhaustion. Paul worked his fingers to the bone, is how we would say it in this life. In fact, when you think of all the apostles, people like Peter and James and John and all the rest, of all the apostles that existed, who worked the hardest? The answer, the Apostle Paul. Nobody outworked Paul. He says it in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. He says, I'm the least of the apostles. I'm not fit to be called an apostle because I persecuted the church of God. Well, why is he one then? Because God called him to be that. It wasn't, Paul didn't make the choice to be an apostle. God chose him for this. He goes on and says, but by the grace of God, I am what I am. And his grace toward me did not prove vain, but I labored, I worked more than all of them. Yet not I, but the grace of God with me. Paul was the hardest working apostle. And I'm telling you, if you want to build credibility about yourself as a Christian, Jesus would say, if you want to be the greatest, be the least. He that serves the most becomes the greatest. You do the work. And listen, credibility doesn't come from a one-time doing one job. It's earned over a long period of time of being consistently faithful in serving over and over and over again. One time's not going to be enough. You got to be there again and again and again and again. But the long-term compounding effect of that builds great credibility in others' minds towards you. They start to say, you know, this person believes what they say. They walk the talk. They're doing what they say they believe matters. Because it's one thing to say it, it's another thing to do it. Paul said, I worked, I labored to the point of exhaustion. And number two, it's not just what you do, but it's what you endure. Largest part of this text talks about all the things that Paul had to endure. Let's go through them and talk about them for just a minute and see what Paul had to suffer here. Number one was imprisonments. If you look at verse 23, he said, in far more imprisonments. You can find five different times in the Bible that Paul went to prison. Hard floors, chains, soldiers, bad food, smells, terrible conditions. There was nothing good about it. Now, I say five times in the Bible because we believe he's probably locked up a lot more than that. There's five that we know of. Sometimes when he was locked up, he stayed in jail for years, lost his freedom. So why was he in jail? Talking about Jesus, preaching the gospel, loving people, helping people get saved. They locked him up for that. What else did he suffer? He said, in far more imprisonments, beaten many times without number. If you've ever been beaten up, you probably remember it. If you've been beaten up more than once, you might can have a number in the back of your mind and say, yeah, I know how many times I've been beat up because I remember every one of them. When Paul says beaten times without number, he's had someone beat him up so many times he's lost count of the number of times he's been beaten up. That's why he says times without number. He said, I can't even remember how many times it's been if I had to add it all up. It's just happened that much. I've been in prison, he says. I've been beaten times without number. He said, I've often been in danger of death. When Paul showed up and started preaching, riots would break out. Mobs would come after him. Sometimes people in the cities would get together and coordinate efforts to develop plots to assassinate Paul. Every time he went somewhere, his life was in danger. He lived with this on a regular daily basis for decades. Five times, verse 24 says, I received from the Jews 39 lashes. This is a penalty that comes out of the book of Deuteronomy. In the book of Deuteronomy, it tells you in chapter 25 that a judgment might be passed against someone where they have violated a law or done something wrong, and based on how bad the law was that was broken, you could give up to 40 stripes, 40 lashes. Now, you didn't have to give that many. If it was a small law, you'd just give a few. They hated Paul so much, the Jewish people in any town would get a hold to him, take him to a public place, strip him, put him down on the ground, or tie him up to something. And because they were Jewish people, in their mind, they're very legalistic, so they'll draw this line, and the line that they draw in their mind is based on what the Word of God says. So the Word of God says you can't beat someone more than 40 times, right? So they never wanted to cross that line because they're legalistic. You can't break the law. So what they would do is they would beat someone 39 times just in case they miscounted, because you don't want to make a mistake and go 41. They'd like to have done it 40, but let's don't take a chance, 39. If somebody hit me with a leather whip one time, I would jump and scream and holler. You would too. A grown man rakes a whip across your bare flesh, your buttocks or your back, 39 times. And Paul kept preaching. They got him and did it again. And they got him and did it again. Five times to this point, he says it's happened. Now, what if you're not Jewish? What if you're Roman? What if you're a Gentile? Well, they would grab you, and they didn't have the idea about the 40 in their mind. They'd just go as long as they wanted to, I guess. But they didn't use the whips. They used rods. But he said, three times I was beaten with rods, verse 25. One time he said, I got stoned. So you think about people getting so mad, they drag you outside the city. They pick up rocks, not softballs, but softball size, rocks. And they start throwing them at your head and your rib cage. So a mob of people surround Paul. They begin slinging them at him. And they are convinced they had beat him to a bloody pulp with these rocks so bad, nobody could have lived through it. They look at him. He's not moving. Can't even see him breathing. They say, well, he's gone. And they leave. But he does take a breath. There's still life in his body. And after he recovers and can stand up, they have stoned him to the point where they're convinced he's dead. What would you do? Because Paul went right back in the city that they just drug him out of. He's tough. Five times, three more times, one time stoned. What else they do to him? I was shipwrecked three times, he says. Now, what's interesting is when Paul writes, his life and his ministry is not over. So a lot of stuff is going to happen after he writes this, including we know at least one more time after this that he gets shipwrecked, because it's in the book of Acts. But timeline-wise, it hasn't even happened yet. One of those times, he says, I spent a day and a night in the deep. Now, can you imagine you're out deep sea fishing in the ocean right here? You're 30 miles off the coast. A storm comes. Your boat breaks apart. And you're out there in the storm, in the water, 24 hours, freezing cold, in the weather, in the elements, maybe sharks circling, maybe you're treading water, maybe you're holding on to a piece of wood, you're too far from land to make it there anytime soon, you hope somebody's going to come by and rescue you. Day and a night I spend in the deep, Paul said. Three times I've been shipwrecked. He said, I've been on frequent journeys, in dangers from rivers. They didn't have bridges like we have today. You had to ford the river, fast rushing water. A lot of people died trying to do it. Paul said, I had to do that a lot. I was in danger when I did it. He said, I'm dangerous from robbers. You traveled back in those days. They didn't have law enforcement. You didn't have cell phones. You didn't have cameras like you do today. People would jump you, beat you up, steal from you, sometimes kill you. He's always in danger from thugs like that. Dangers from my countrymen, fellow Jews, dangers from the Gentiles, dangers in the city, certainly every city he went in, dangers in the wilderness. Paul would go places that other people would find real hard to get to. He'd take roads most people wouldn't take because there was people there that needed Jesus. He'd walk those roads, but you think about what might be down those small country roads. Animals, the weather, all sorts of dangers might be there. But he says, dangers in the wilderness. I lost my place here. Dangers on the sea, we've kind of talked about that already. Dangers among false brethren. And it's bad enough when you're outside the church to have to face down some of these things. But Jesus said that in the church, there's going to be wheat and there's going to be tares. There's going to be the real and there's going to be some phony that gets sown in among the wheat. And when the phonies come in and they become part of the church, you can't tell that they're not real. They look the same. They learn the lingo. They talk like everybody else. They act like everybody else. But every now and then, some of them will get together and sometimes work together. And they're not part of God's family. They don't follow Jesus. So they're actually part of the enemy's camp. And they show their true colors. And so Paul sometimes would have people from within the church attack them, and they weren't even real believers. False brethren. Phonies, fakes. In fact, that's some of what he's dealing with in the church of Corinth. So again, bad enough when you're outside the church, but then you come into the church family and you think, well, this is a safe zone. Paul wasn't even safe with any of the churches. Some of them, the ones that he had planted, founded himself. He said, I've been in labor. I've been in hardship through many sleepless nights. You ever have a night where you couldn't get to sleep? What's some of the things that kept you asleep? Because I want you to see what kept Paul asleep. I was hungry. I was thirsty. You ever been so hungry you couldn't get to sleep and you had nothing to eat? They didn't have fast food joints. They didn't have convenience stores. They didn't have grocery stores. If you didn't have food, you just didn't have food. Paul may not have had it, or he may not have had the money to buy it. But sometimes he'd lay in bed at night and he was so thirsty or so hungry he couldn't even sleep. He said, without food and cold and exposure, there's some other reasons. You know, right now you might have an umbrella, you might have a tarp in your car, you might have a poncho, something like that. Can you think about the exposure to the elements as Paul's traveling, going from city to city, things he might face from snow and blizzards and sleet, cold, rain, wind, thunderstorms, lightning? If that's coming down at night and you're trying to sleep, there's no sleeping. Paul lived a hard life. He went through a lot. Now, let me ask you something. Is he credible? Yeah. Very much so. Because who's going to get locked up, beaten, shipwrecked, and say, I'm going to keep going, even though I know I'm just a fake? I'm just a phony, and I'm, you know, it's not real. And no, he's completely credible. Nobody would. You'd give up the first time. I would, too. Who wouldn't? Why'd he keep going? God called him. Jesus saved him. He's real. He's an apostle. And we need to know that because 2,000 years later, when the church is getting attacked even now and even from within the church, people don't like what Paul wrote about femininity and masculinity and about marriage and about sexuality and about homosexuality and about salvation. There's all sorts of stuff Paul wrote that even to this day he gets attacked over. But I'm going to tell you something. You can't say he wasn't real. You may not like what he said, but what he said was authoritative. It came from Jesus. He's the real deal. He's got to be. And what he wrote stands. And I'm going to tell you, sometimes when you suffer and people watch you and they say, you know, she didn't quit. He kept going. They didn't give up on God in that hard time. They endured. They made it through. They pressed on. They kept the faith. That builds credibility in other people's minds. They see what you're doing, and they know the same thing about you that's known about Paul. She's real. He's real. You build credibility that way. It matters that you do. It's not all it does, but it does matter. What you do builds credibility. What you endure builds credibility. And what you feel builds credibility. Look at verse 28. He says, apart from such external things, there's the daily pressure on me of concern for all the churches. He said, who's weak without my being weak? Who is led into sin without my intense concern? You know, the first verse here, he's talking about the church as a whole. You know, sometimes churches as a whole struggle. They go through hard times, difficulties. Sometimes in this day, in the first century, the churches he was involved with would get persecuted from outside. That could have been one of the things that worried him. But it's not just the church as a whole that bothers him. You look at the next verse and he says, who's weak that I'm not weak? Who gets brought into sin and I'm not broken over it? It was individuals. He wasn't just concerned about the macro. He's concerned about the micro, the individual person. It mattered to him. You know, people know what matters to you. They can tell. They can tell if, you know, you care about them. It's been said before, people don't really care what you know until they know how much you care. There's a lot of truth to that. And when people know that you matter to them or that they matter to you, it starts to build credibility because they say, you know, I can trust this person. This person has shown me over and over again through tears that have been cried and prayers that have been prayed and acts of service that have been performed that love is there, that person isn't speaking into my life just to try to get one over on me, but actually they're trying to help me. I mean, it builds credibility, doesn't it? So when you have empathy and you become your brother's keeper and you really care about people, it shows, it builds credibility. What you do, what you endure, and what you feel, they all matter. So with that in mind, let's think about some things that might work to give us application about this, especially concerning the idea of suffering that Paul talks so much about that he went through here. One of the things I'll just say to you is this. Sometimes people go through really, really difficult times, and they're good people, at least from a world's point of view. Now, I know the Bible says no one's good, no, not one. And that's true. We're all sinners. We all need a Savior. We all need Jesus. But sometimes there are some people that just live a good, decent life. You know, there's that lady that's a really good mom. She volunteers for the PTA and at the school. She works on the son's soccer team as the soccer mom leader. And I mean, just, you know, sacrifices for the community and works in the church. I mean, just a good, rock-solid person. And then something really bad happens, and you scratch your head and go, you know, why'd that have to happen to somebody like that? And, you know, you may turn that around and say, you know, I've had that question in my own mind about myself, preacher. I've not really done anything where I deserve to really have such terrible things happen in my life, but I've had some really bad things happen. But, you know, when you look at the Apostle Paul, he's a really good guy, really loved Jesus, really loved people, really laid himself out there to be a servant. And he went through some tough stuff. I don't ever want you in your mind to think that because I'm decent and I'm good and I love Jesus and I'm hardworking, that that's going to mean that you're not going to go through hard times. In fact, it may work out the exact opposite for you. It may be that the very fact that you're so faithful to Jesus is going to make life even more difficult for you. That's just a reality. Jesus spoke and he said, in this world, you're going to have tribulation. What does that mean? It means trouble. Now, you take that, you write that down, stick it on your refrigerator. You can memorize that this week. That'll be your memory verse this week. What did Jesus promise me? He promised me I'm going to have trouble. That's exactly what he meant. He said, in this world, I'm your peace. I've come that you might have peace. He said, in this world, you're going to have tribulation. Every one of us is going to have trouble in this world. Things that we don't want, things that we really can't handle, and we need God's help with, but it's coming our way. Not just are we going to have trouble, but we're also going to have persecution. Here's a promise that Paul wrote out of 2 Timothy. He said this in verse 12 of chapter 3. All who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. You want to live for Jesus? You want to live the right way? Do the right sorts of things? You want to share the gospel with people? You're going to be persecuted. In fact, Paul, as he writes 2 Timothy, is in jail again. So one of the times we know he was in jail, and he's about to die. And he explains why. But as he does it, we start to see not only a purpose behind the suffering, but even a necessity that it brings with it. Listen to what he writes in chapter 2. He said, to Paul, writing to Timothy, Paul writes and says, remember Jesus Christ, risen from the dead, descendant of David, according to my gospel. Remember the gospel, that word means good news. It's the good news of Jesus. And we all tell it in a different way. There's lots of ways to share it. So Paul says, remember my gospel, but the heart of it is that Jesus came according to the Scriptures. He's one of the three persons of God. He is the Son of God. He came in flesh. He was humanity and deity together. He lived a perfect life, died on a cross, went in our place, paid for our sin, rose from the dead on the third day, and is now ascended to heaven, but he's going to come back, and all who might believe in him can receive the free gift of eternal life. If you'll repent of your sin today, you can know salvation full and free through Jesus. That's good news. That's gospel. Paul said, remember my gospel for which I suffer hardship, even into imprisonment as a criminal. He said, but the word of God is not in prison. For this reason I endure all things, including what? Imprisonment as a criminal. They locked him up like a common criminal because he preached Jesus. For this reason I endure all things for the sake of those who are chosen, so they also may obtain the salvation which is in Christ Jesus and with it eternal glory. Paul said, I got locked up because I preached Jesus. Now, when I preached Jesus, people got saved. That's what he's excited about. I preached Jesus, people got saved, but they locked me up for it. He said, but I'm willing to endure getting locked up if that's what it's going to take for people to get saved. Now, that's his message here. But I told you it serves a purpose and it gives us a necessity. So look what he says in these next verses. It is a trustworthy statement, Paul writes. If we died with him, we're going to live with him. If we endure, we will also reign with him. Now here he sets up one side. Those who endure what? Suffering, hardship, aches, pains of life, persecution, things that the devil throws at us, things that the world throws at us. When you don't quit, when you keep on going, it becomes evidence in your life that you really are a genuine, credible Christian. You truly belong to Jesus. It's a necessity that you endure. Because he says in the next part, if we deny him, he will also deny us. When does he do that? Judgment day. You stand before him. Depart from me, he says. I never knew you. When you suffer, when you're persecuted, and you say, I've had it, that's enough, I'm done, and you walk away. I'm done with Jesus, done with the Bible, done with church, don't want nothing to do with any of it anymore. We deny him. Judgment day comes. We never belonged to him. I never knew you, he says. Depart from me. If we are faithless, he remains faithful, for he cannot deny himself. You can't deny Jesus, even in the midst of suffering. So one of the purposes suffering brings about is that it purges the church. It purifies it. Pain that comes for following Jesus demonstrates that some are going to endure, meaning they truly belong to Jesus. Some are going to fall away and quit, meaning they never belonged to him to start with. So suffering has something there for us to remember that there's a good thing that God produces from it. But Paul says at the very last part of this text in 2 Timothy, he says, I'm already being poured out as a drink offering. The time of my departure has come. He's locked up in jail because shortly after this, they're going to take him away, and we believe Nero is going to have his head chopped off. So he closes out his book and says, I fought the good fight. I finished the course, meaning what? I finished my race. He says, I have kept the faith. Kept the faith. When it's time to struggle and suffer and hardship came, Paul did not get destroyed by the bad things that came into his life. Instead, he held on to the faith and endured and persevered. He kept on in spite of what he faced. I kept the faith and I finished the race. We live in a day when a lot of people are dropping out of the race. Have you noticed? It's in the news all the time. If we deny him, he'll deny us. You got to finish the race. But there's a good thing about it if you do. You finish the race and you suffer and you persevere. In the end, you get heaven and you get a great reward too. You know, there was a, there's a sermon Jesus preached, and in the first part of it, there's a section called the Beatitudes, the parts where it talks about being blessed. Listen to what it says. This is Jesus speaking. He says, "Blessed are those who have been persecuted for the sake of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." Meaning, if you're persecuted for righteousness' sake, that's good evidence in your life. You're truly born again. You belong to Jesus. You're saved. Then he goes on and says, "Blessed are you when people insult you and persecute you and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward in heaven is great." Get a great reward to go along with it. You know, all suffering that you experience in life, I believe there's a reward for it. All of it. God doesn't waste your pain. You endure something, a hardship, there's a glorious return on what you had to go through. But he especially rewards suffering for Jesus. Great is your reward in heaven. Do you remember when the apostles were locked up in the book of Acts chapter 5 and they were beaten, they were flogged, it says, and then released? And they went away rejoicing. They did exactly what Jesus said in the Beatitudes. They went away rejoicing. Now, you lock me up in jail, have me beaten like Paul's been beaten, and then let me go. Am I going to whine and complain, or should I say, praise the Lord, hallelujah, glory to God? Now, the second thing is what you should be doing. Because he said, great is your reward in heaven. When your eyes are on eternity and your perspective is beyond this life into the next life, it makes all the difference in the world. They said that the apostles went away rejoicing because they were counted worthy to have suffered for the name. They were overjoyed that Jesus found them worthy to experience persecution in this life, so that they might experience a great reward in the next life. Thank you, Jesus, that you let this come in my life. That was their attitude. And based on what Jesus said, it's the right attitude. I'll close with this thought, because we're in 2 Corinthians, and we've already been through this. This is chapter 4. I'll just give it to you again, just to remind you of it. Paul says in verse 17, "Momentary light affliction is producing for us an eternal weight of glory far beyond comparison, while we look not at the things which we are seen, but the things which are not seen." You know what's interesting about that? I think about all that stuff I just read that Paul went through. Dangers where? Gentiles, Jews, in the city, in the country. I'm hungry at night. I'm thirsty at night. I can't get to sleep. The weather is tearing me up. I've been locked up. I've been beat on. Shipwrecked. And Paul in this verse, knowing what he's going to be writing later, in chapter 4 said this, it's momentary light affliction. Wow. Now, I haven't ever been through anything as bad as what Paul's been through. But now Paul's talking about what he went through too. And he says it's what? It's momentary and it's light. Now, if something's heavy and weighty, you know, there's a comparison there. What does he say is heavy and weighty? He says God is preparing for us an eternal weight of glory. You put the two on the scales, one's going to tip one way, one's going to tip the other. Momentary light affliction. Now, I've never been through anything as bad as what Paul's been through, which tells me that anything I go through in this life is even lighter than what Paul had to go through. And if what he went through is light, then I know my stuff is light. But also know this. In the scales of eternity, even if I live to be 100 and every day after this is painful and hard, compared to days without end, a weighty glory that's exchanged for the momentary light affliction, when I get there, it's actually going to be that I'm glad that I went through what I went through, because it produced something for me. That's what it says. Produces for us an eternal weight of glory. Momentary light affliction. Are you afflicted right now? Are you suffering anyway? Not just for Jesus, in any way. A momentary light affliction produces for you an eternal weight of glory. That's awesome. So I can rejoice even in the midst of suffering, can't I? I can learn from this text today. I need to keep my eyes looking beyond this life into the next life. I've got to remember that what we're going through right now is momentary. It's going to end. There will be a day when all this is over. There's no more suffering, no more sorrows, no more tears, no more pain, no more death, no more dying. Eternal glory forever. And the time that I spend in this life gets rewarded the next when it's been lived for Jesus. So I don't need to give up. I don't need to quit, do I? You don't either. We all do. What do we need to do? We're running a race. And every day is one day closer to that finish line. Some of you have been running a long time now. This isn't time to give up. Don't you want to be running hard when that day comes and you cross that line? I don't want to be limping across. I want to be going full steam ahead as fast as I can. There it is. It's coming. And I want to cross that line and fall right in the arms of Jesus. Don't quit before your race is over. Don't give up. Keep pushing on. You say, well, it might cost me something to serve Jesus. It might be tough. I might have to pay a price. Pay it. It'd be worth it. You'd be glad you did. Don't think in terms of what you're going to lose here now. Think in terms of what you gain later on. That's the whole different perspective God wants us to have. That's the difference maker. Why did Paul endure what he endured? We need it. Church back then needed it. There's a great reward for doing it. Do you think in eternity right now he's glad he went through it? I guarantee you he is. Was it fun when he was going through it? No, hated every minute of it. I wouldn't want somebody beating on me. I wouldn't want to be locked up in prison. But he's not locked up anymore. It's been 2,000 years he's been there. 20,000 years, 200,000 years, 2 million years from now. What was that in comparison to what he's got for all of eternity? Think like that. If you don't know the Lord Jesus Christ, there's no better need in your life right now, no greater need. You need to put your faith in Christ, surrender your life to him today, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and be saved. Now, I'd love to help you to do that. For the rest of us that know Jesus, you keep running. You keep looking ahead, and you be a good soldier for King Jesus. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for your word today. Thank you for your people today, for your blessings of life that have been given to us. And Lord, for this challenge that you've put before us. God, we don't want to be complainers. We don't want to be whiners. Lord, we look at what Paul went through and the stuff that we think is such a big deal, is so small and petty sometimes by comparison. But thank you for men and women of God that have paid the price so that we might have the knowledge that we have today, that we might have the churches we have, that we might have the lives that we have. Thank you for these graces that you've bestowed on us. God, may we prepare the way for the ones coming behind us. May we pay the price that needs to be paid so the gospel continues to be spread, people continue to know Christ and get saved. And God, we'll thank you in eternity for what you let us do in this life. God, help us even this day during this invitation. Do whatever you lead us to do, however you want us to act. In Jesus' name we pray. Church, let's stand up. Let's sing together. Brother Mark's going to lead us. And if I can help you to know Christ, would you step out and come today?